Tony van Rooij, Dr. Tony van Rooij, Project Lead Gaming, Gambling and Media Literacy at the Trimbos Institute. You are specialized in addictions. Okay, now I have one question for the three of you. What is your favorite game that you love playing? And I'll start first so you have a second to think about it. I play Ruzzle, which is like world food. It's a board game. It's nothing else. It's the only game I play. And I realize I've played it so much that when I fall asleep, you know, then I have these little letters in my brain appearing and I'm trying to organize them into order. So I think I'm on the brink of addiction there. Anyway, what's your favorite game?
Stardew Valley. Yeah.
And what's so great about Stardew Valley?
Oh, because you're in sort of another world, but it's really a computer world, so it doesn't look really fancy in that respect. So it's really blocks and things. But you need to discover a lot of things. You need to build a farm and then...
It's more the creative discovery aspect.
Yeah, and there's a lot of secret things that you can find out in the game. So it's sort of a puzzle.
It has to be hard to make it fun, of course, too.
There needs to be something to achieve.
Yeah, exactly. Achievement, that's it. Max, what's your favorite game?
I play a lot of Tekken, actually. Yeah, that might be my favorite game right now. Mostly with my 15-year-old daughter, which is lots of fun.
That's nice. Yeah, it's a social game in a way as well.
Well, in this way, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So we learn a lot about...
And what do you do in Tekken? Because I don't know.
You have two characters that fight against each other. So it's a fighting game, actually. Uh-huh. Yeah, yeah.
You have to kill people.
No, not at all. You're just like, it's kind of like a wrestling match almost, right? Okay. So a little bit staged there. And you have to learn a lot about button combinations and... a lot about frustration, actually, as well, like in a game like this.
I see something positive coming out of why one should play games. We'll come back to that in a minute as well. And what about you?
I was also going to say Stardew Valley.
Oh, really? Oh,
but
because now
it's such a nice, friendly game to play. But looking back, I guess I made most online friends when I was still heavily involved in World of Warcraft back in the day. Yeah. It's still active, but I'm not playing
still
anymore.
Active. What is it, 18 years now? It's amazing how long this world exists.
It's a long game, and they even restarted the entire game, so they're restarting from scratch again.
And one day soon, you will go back there, and this will be your life.
I don't have the time anymore, I'm afraid.
No, that's it. When you retire, you suddenly will go back to World of Warcraft. Yeah. Why are we talking about these games? Okay, games can be addictive. They can influence what people do and how they behave, and that can be negative, but it can also be positive. There are certain game mechanics in play that have that result. Now, in this hour, we want to talk about why we play games, what the positive and negative results were, but we also especially want to talk about the research that the three of you have done into these game mechanics and what the recommendations are to make them better, or at least less harmful for children, actually for anybody that could be harmed by those games. Now, I've read the report. I mean, it's super fascinating. And it's also almost like a guidebook to how to make games addictive, right? I mean, you describe all the mechanics that happen in these games, in these video games, that one, you know, the companies use to have people stay longer or spend more money or, you know, stay in the world and never go away. It's time and money, basically, that game companies are after. Now, that sounds sort of negative. And video games this month were, in the news a lot because the Chinese government said, now it's enough. We put a limit on how many hours a child can play video games, which probably for a lot of parents was a fantastic solution. You know, no more discussions there. But in the report, you describe both also the reasons why it's actually really interesting to play games. Who wants to tell us why do people play games? What is the reason for people to play games?
Well, I think Max would be...
Max, you go first, yeah. And it's a conversation, so always feel free to pitch in.
Yeah, I think from a perspective of learning, like this one part, right? So we play like for ages, actually, like we engage in play, right, on multiple levels, and it's a great preparation, actually, for things that we face like in the outside, like in our overall world, right? So if you think about like gameplay today, I think there's lots that we learn about like communication with others, right? Engaging in complex topics, interpreting data and information, right? So there's like lots of benefits like in that direction. And I think people play because they enjoy themselves while being in play worlds, right? While engaging with something that's fantastical, interesting, maybe a little bit challenging as well, right? Like where they feel like they have something that's very clear as a task they have to overcome. So there are lots of these aspects that drive people into play. Like we can go into motivational theories, of course, in depth of explaining a little bit more what drives people there. But yeah. I think we might leave that for
later. Yeah. No, so people have sort of mastery and they enjoy themselves and they might learn some skills that are useful later in life, like cooperation. I mean, let me be the very old person here and say, but okay, if they wouldn't play games all the time, they would learn all these skills in the real world, right? I mean, it is an escapist form of learning. I mean, trying to, you know, convince me.
I think I would start with that, you know, like games are really very much like part of the real world, right? Like, yes, they provide us like with environments that are maybe fantastical or simulations of, or have like world contexts that are not like situated like in the real world, but they very much are part of our real world fabric, right? Else we wouldn't like talk about this right now. So I think there's like a huge kind of like influence of or way of being kind of like drawn in into game worlds for looking for experiences that we don't necessarily find or have like in our everyday life, right? Or ways that we can engage in and kind of like, yeah, really really change and alter a little bit how we think about like what's possible and what's impossible like in day-to-day life.
So it's really culture. I mean, it's like art and literature and culture. It takes you to another world where you can experience new things.
Yeah, some of them are really provocative as well about how we think about the world around us, right? So Detroit Become Human, for example, like displays a lot of ways of engaging kind of with how the world would look like if androids would be around, if artificial intelligence would kind of like on a day-to-day basis like change our life, right? So, and provides a glimpse into that future as well, and allows us to make moral decisions in those environments as well. So,
And of course we are. I mean, especially the last 18 months. I mean, I think gameplay was up 50% or something. I mean, incredible. You know, we were stuck at home, and games and video and movies, literature. They were our escape. We were still part of the world through these.
Especially during Corona, it provided a really nice opportunity for people to be together online.
Yeah.
On the positive side, and also on the positive side, it provides people with opportunities to experiment with different behaviors. So back in the day when I was still playing World of Warcraft, my guild leader was a taxi driver in daily life, but online he was leading 40 people, and believe me, we're doing complicated things and achieving them.
Yeah. Working together and
so it does mentally and socially, it provides a lot for people, and that should not be underestimated or downplayed. On the other hand, if you speak to physicians or eye physicians in particular, they are a little bit nervous about all the sitting down and the effect
not
on
moving
your
around
eyes
in itself, but it could be reading a book, same thing.
Exactly, right? And you have to account for daily activity as well. If school systems are designed in such a way that children are sitting down all day and they come home and they play Fortnite all night, then they're sitting too much. It's not necessarily Fortnite's problem, but it is a lot of sitting.
Yeah.
And you're going to notice that in 10 years.
Yes, and a lot of people after these 18 months are now so used to living in those imaginary worlds and finding their entertainment there. I mean, we have to get them outside a little bit more, maybe. But the reason why we talk about games is not the part where you don't play games. It's the part where we do play games. Mm-hmm. And you're an addiction specialist. If I understand correctly from the report, most people, even if they really love a game, are not addicted to a game. But there is a group, 7% of boys, that is really likely to experience some problems just by not being able to get away from the game, right? There's a small group for whom it is really quite damaging.
Well, yeah. So we tend to reserve the term addiction for people that are actually patients. So they don't show up for school anymore. They need to go to the clinic, or their parents take them to the clinic because they're not functional anymore. So that's a fairly small group.
It is even smaller than.
Yeah, exactly. And then there's a bigger group. And then if you do a survey study in whatever school you want, you're going to find a certain percentage. In this case, 7% or 4% or doesn't really matter. There is a percentage of children that indicate that they are having some problems related to their social media or gaming behavior.
Yeah.
And that's something to be taken serious, even if it's not a bona fide treatable addiction.
Yeah.
It can be a precursor to eventual life problems. But those problems are problems. They're not getting around to their homework. They're having trouble concentrating. The games are distracting.
And that's not necessarily a game topic as such, in the sense that it's also TikTok and Twitter and Netflix, and there's no time for boredom because there's so much entertainment and a constant stream of information you can access.
There is, but extending that in the report also, games do these days try to grasp your resources. They try to take your time or your money, and obviously they're commercial in nature. But 20 years ago, a game would not ask you to be present this weekend or miss out on this item, and otherwise you have to wait a year or pay 10 euros to get it right now.
Yeah, they managed to get the group pressure into the game, and they managed to get this challenge of liveness, you know, to be there in the game as well. The big demands that games start.
Games have gotten more complicated, a lot more complicated.
And just to go to this topic briefly about the claim against TikTok, because I mentioned TikTok because it's also such a time. I mean, I've got a 15-year-old at home, you know. She can sit for hours. I mean, and it's super entertaining. Yeah. You've made a part of a mass claim even against TikTok on behalf of consumers. Yeah. Why is that? Because that seems then there's really something wrong, right?
I've not done this personally. I'm part of the foundation that has filed a claim against TikTok, and I'm in the supervisory committee of that foundation. And the claim is based on particularly data protection concerns. Children are acknowledged a high level of data protection under the rules that we have. And TikTok does a lot of things, at least that's in the claim. We claim that they do a lot of things in their app that are actually violating those rules in general, also for other users, but in particular for children as well. So they collect a lot of data of children. They profile children in a certain way. Everything, and there we also get back, I think, to the topic that we've been looking into, and everything in that respect is connected to the business model that TikTok has, because they make a lot of money by advertising or other marketing strategies. Some strategies are not so clear in TikTok, which also raises consumer law issues. So there are data protection and consumer law issues, and all through that we also see children's rights issues, because there is a lot of even younger children that use the app, and you really need to you really need to factor in that they have a higher level of protection.
So there, in the case of TikTok and probably in the case of games, there are some areas where you can go to the law and just demand better protection, but the research is about something completely different. That's actually about the mechanics of the game.
Yeah.
You can go to the law, you can ask children and education systems to, you know, make sure they move around enough, but in the end, it's also about the game. Now, I loved reading about all these little tricks and the things games do to get your time and money, and maybe you could explain a few. I mean, I was, you know... The loot box, for instance, what was that? It's gambling almost, but you can explain. What does the loot box do?
I think the loot boxes I'm going to pass over to you, Tony.
Okay, Tony. Well, that's very close to the addiction part, right? The gambling.
Yes,
and so what is a loot box? I mean, pretend.
Well, that I can explain. What it exactly does in the long run is less clear. Yeah. So basically, I guess you have to go back a step. And then when I was growing up, I just went to the store and I bought a game, and it was in a box, and I paid once and then I got the game.
Yeah.
So from the perspective of the game designer also, at that point the transaction was concluded and they wanted to deliver a good game so that I don't request my money back after 5 minutes, and they want me to have fun.
Yeah.
Their money is already in the pocket. And this has fundamentally changed. And initially it became... It's entangled with the development of the internet, I would say, and especially mobile phones as in particular, where smaller and smaller transactions for in-game content became more prevalent in games. So you don't buy the entire game, you buy a large chunk of the game, And the last part you can buy for an additional 10 euros or 15 euros or 2 euros if you wanted the purple horse instead of the regular horse.
Yeah.
That phenomenon is known as microtransactions, although sometimes they're not as micro as you might think.
And usually also in game money, right? So they're sort of a little bit different from euros or dollars. They're like game money, so it doesn't feel like money.
That's something that happens that has become an industry standard, is that they change your money into something else.
Yeah.
And they always change it into something else that's not exactly 1 euro. It's always 799 gems or Smurf berries or whatever.
Yeah, coins.
And then you're instantly confused. So that's a small trick that's used to detach your conception that you're actually spending money when you're spending those gems. But if you run out of gems, you need to buy them again.
Yeah.
That's the model.
But
going back to the business models, the microtransactions and the smaller and smaller transactions became really dominant, to the point that people started experimenting with them as well. And one of the most recent experiments is putting them in a treasure box. And you don't know what's in the box. It might be something really cool. It might be something nonsensical.
Yeah.
But you open the box, and then a gambling type of animation generally plays, and you get a lot of flashy lights, and you get audio feedback that you really want something special.
Yeah, it's like the and reward systems of your brain are...
And then you got nothing, or you got something brilliant.
Yeah.
And the question being raised is, this resembles gambling so much that are we exposing children to gambling?
It's like buying a lottery ticket, right? You win something or you lose something. I mean, it's
a lot faster than buying a lottery ticket.
Yeah.
So
lotteries
are not they're not viewed as that problematic, because there's a time between sale and the drawing of the prize.
Yeah.
But here it's immediate. So that can be...
So that's the loot
risky
box. That's definitely one where... You know, money is taken, and that's already, it's an area where you could almost say, oh, maybe that shouldn't happen, especially for children, you know.
Well, there's risks involved.
Yeah, it's gambling.
Some of them we know, and some of them we suspect.
But there's also like buying a beautiful skin, or, you know, changing yourself in the game. Or there were examples in the report of games where the game gets slower and slower, and up to the point that you pay more money, or even the game where if you play long enough, then you win. So there's different systems. Mark, can you give some other systems? So you have the loot box, and what other systems in the game mechanics are there?
I often really like to also to focus like on small elements, like kind of the interface itself, right? Mm-hmm. So like just the way we are kind of like restarting basically like a game in there, right? So do I actually have like a complicated mechanism where I have to press like the X button, for example, hold it for a while, and then like start the next game? Or am I like very quickly kind of just getting into the next game, right? So it's almost like what you're experiencing on Facebook or on Twitter or like on TikTok as well, right?
Or even on Netflix, where the next episode starts.
That's right,
without
right? So we get immediately sucked into it, right? Yeah. Like, and I think like that's kind of like the level where we are also seeing like behavioral manipulation, like really not necessarily from a negative perspective, right? There are situations where I really want to kind of like keep on playing, and that might be the right part, but it's a part that can be exploited quite easily to keep me drawn in. And that comes back kind of like to the part that Tony talks about, like addressed like in microtransactions, right? It's like from a sales perspective, it's important to keep me engaged, right? To keep me over and over like within the game for as long as possible, so that the social comparison part like increases, right? That's where skins, for example, come in. Like, how do I express myself like
within
the game?
Your sense of status is
exactly.
You can buy status.
Yeah, you can buy status, and alongside you can win status, right? Like, so those are often come together. Like, you play for a long time, and then you get status. But you could also pay for your status and like for the way you individually want to like represent yourself in a game. Mm. Yeah.
That doesn't feel like you really win. But anyway, that's even in Russell you can buy that. Never buy. No, but so there's another system that's basically a draw on your time to keep you in the game longer. There's different systems to take more money out. Is time and money, are those the things, or are there other things that games try to achieve? I mean,
I think like the attention aspect. You mean like from a kind of behavioral kind of like? I think so. We talk a little like, or we're addressing right now more the negative side kind of like of drawing people in, right? But of course, like there is a large part of game design that's very enjoyment focused, like where game designers are interested in creating scenarios, situations that are inherently fun for people to engage in.
Yeah.
and to explore, right? So I think that's a very important kind of other side. But and we line this out in the report, I think, very nicely, that there is a conflict at one point if we are suggesting that there is enjoyment and engagement in a certain form, like in a game, and that is frustrated, right? So my expectation is actually not what I was looking for, but now I have to invest, for example, an extreme amount of time to kind of like get to a goal, right? To achieve
something. You get four levels, but the fifth is forever in the
distance.
Or pay. It's what is also called, I think, in the report, the behavioral design patterns. You have some dark patterns, really, that are, you know, either on your time or on your money, but also on your social connections or your psychology even.
Right.
What is of all the things that you three have seen, what is the thing where you really thought, like, this is not good? What is the worst example? I mean, we've seen very good games. We've discussed how interesting and fun and enjoyable games are, but there are things going on. What are the extremes in the industry?
I think one of the extremes that we see is like impostering like others socially, right? Like, so for example, like in Farmville, there are examples of others basically impostering someone from your social network, like that visits your own farm.
It seems to be your friend that does it, but it's the machine that actually suggests that, and it's not your friend.
Mm. Yeah. Right. So that I think that's very specific, like for digital environments, that we can manipulate the information that we're seeing and that are presented to us as well, right? And from a commercial perspective, that might be very interesting. And then,
And that feels wrong, but of course legally there's nothing wrong with it. It's a game.
No, there is a lot wrong with that actually.
Yeah? Okay. Tell us.
I mean, a lot of the examples that we've heard now actually. Are actually not allowed under consumer law. So we have something that we call unfair commercial practices, and they can be misleading. So the example that Tony mentioned about, or maybe it was you, about the value of in-game money and it not being clear actually how much it is. You see the same on TikTok, by the way. But in a lot of games as well, from a consumer law perspective, that needs to be explained in a way that people actually know what the value is. Not being clear about that something, that a certain strategy is marketing, is also misleading. So we have misleading unfair commercial practices, and we have also aggressive unfair commercial practices. And while you were asking what is the worst thing that can happen, well, there is I think there are a number of examples, but I mean, playing on a person's vulnerabilities, which is actually what dark patterns do, they make you do things that the company wants you to do because they want to make profit, not the things that you yourself necessarily want to do. So those are dark patterns. And one of the things that may be happening is, for instance, that you are made feel, you're being made feel bad about yourself. You're not good enough. So in order to get better, you need to buy stuff, look better,
have better. It seems to be the basis of capitalist society, go on.
So you're playing on people's self-confidence. And this can also be automated, by using algorithms, by using AI. In terms of, there is a sort of a matchmaking AI system where people are being put together in a game in a way. Don't ask me how it works exactly, but they're put together in a way. So they know that this is the best match in order to make people buy things. And what I think is
somebody who's really strong, and then the other thing, like, I want to be in that league, and then they're going to buy lots of something in that field.
Yeah, so you play on the vulnerabilities.
And they can test these constellations.
Yeah. So you play on the vulnerabilities, but the other thing that is happening there, it's completely invisible that this is happening. So what we found also in the research, that you need to really dive into patents that are filed by companies to see that they're actually developing these kinds of systems to find out that they're probably using them. You don't really see it from
it's
playing
also
the game.
It's dark in a way that's completely invisible.
Yeah, so that's really dark, because it's totally obscure.
There's an interesting line in the report that, yes, humans are completely irrational, but you need to give them all the data anyway. And they might still decide to spend all that game money or live their whole weekend in World of Warcraft. That doesn't matter, but they need to know the systems. So there's a sort of an information...
Well, I would maybe also go a step further. I think that some of these dark patterns, you might actually ask yourself whether you should allow them in games at all. And maybe even you know, sooner for children than for adults. They maybe, you know, maybe able to manage it a little bit better. But also, I think for a lot of adults, it's mm-hmm. you know, it works on your unconscious. So it's impossible really to make decisions there, even yeah. if you yeah. wanted to.
Even if you are aware, it would still happen yeah. because it's yeah. not you know.
Yeah, and what we see is that this has changed, like Tony said, with the business models that have been changing. You used to buy a box with a game, and yeah. that was it. And now they're making the money in a different way. And it's not a problem that they're making money. But it's a problem that they're manipulating people in ways that can be harmful for them.
Is there, I mean, you are specialized in especially the children's rights in this area. You also made a code about what game designers or on the whole people should think about when they develop these products and services for children. And one of the very specific things in there was that children should have the right to play and also in that play make their own decisions, have some, you know, agency.
Yeah,
and games like Minecraft, where there's creative aspects, and you can do things and find your people. So, is there a whole group of games that you would personally say it's best if children don't play those games?
Oh, I wouldn't say that they shouldn't play games. I think a lot of children would be really angry with me if I said that.
That's what we're parents for. No, but is yeah. there other groups of games? And not all games, but are there certain games where you feel like, okay, this kind of game with these kind of mechanics, that really shouldn't be used for children?
Yeah, I don't think it's the whole games, or you know, the whole game. It's rather specific mechanics. So what we call dark patterns. Where I would say don't use them on children, and some are, like I said, some are not allowed already. Don't use them on children, and some of them also don't use them on adults. So it's not entire games, because I can see that play. Maybe it's nice to mention that children have a right to play.
A lot of people don't know that.
It's also called the forgotten right, and it's actually essential that children play, and. I think also adults should maybe play more. but it's an essential activity because of the things that Mark's mentioned before. You learn a lot. It's you know, important for creativity, for imagination. They also take their play offline, you know. They're inspired by games to do things offline, play out characters or storylines, or maybe start building things because they're in Minecraft, you know. So there is an interaction also between the offline and the online there. So I think it's essential for them to play, but we need to focus on these particular mechanisms, I think, that we know can be harmful to
but
to
it
people.
Makes it actually harder. I mean, I understand, because it means you have to first understand the mechanics, then decide is it allowed or not advisable, or maybe just for children or those mechanics. But then, I mean, how on earth are you going to convince the game developers that this makes sense?
But I think there is an aspect of, and our report aims for this as well, to develop a language first, right? Yeah. So that we are actually able to communicate with each other. And this divide, like, between children and their parents in itself, right? So that speaking the same language, understanding how a game actually works, which mechanics are employed, which kind of dark patterns are used, like, in there as well, I think is a very important step to also, right, influence commercial practice at the end. Because only if I'm able to talk about where the problems actually lie, what the effects might be, what the effects on a day-to-day situation might be, right? So, for example, the dinner situation, like, where does that become problematic because someone doesn't show up because they are so engaged and involved? How can we deal with those situations? How can we talk about them from a design perspective as well, right? Like, where design kind of creates situations where it's more likely that this happens, but also how can design be used to kind of help to curb with some of those, like, some of those situations and help to prevent them?
Right, like, so if you were in China, you would say, you know, all games are down at 6 o'clock in the evening. But you've worked in China. I mean, you worked in a Chinese game company. That must be super fascinating. Yeah. What, I mean, did you work with the people actually developing the mechanics? What area of the company were you in?
Yeah, so I worked in the marketing and user research department of Tencent for 3 months as an internship, right? So this is not like a long time.
Yeah, but you had a look that few people
I had
here
a look, yeah. Behind the curtain, yeah.
So how did they develop these mechanics? Because they are working on that.
Like, I did not directly work, like, with the groups that developed.
But you could see what they tried to test, because you were in the research group.
I saw parts of it, but I had my own research like within the groups, right? Okay. So you get a glimpse of kind of like the environment and of the user evaluation that like happens on the other side, right? But I don't think any of these are like very the secret in any way. It's like common marketing practice of understanding how much people engage, right? If you look into skin sales, for example, right? It's like how much skins are sold, under which conditions, how do characters need to be designed that resonates, which characters resonate, like those are all open questions kind of like for the industry, right? And they measure those and benchmark those.
Yeah. So it's a lot of research there.
Yeah. Well, the question is what counterbalances the commercial pressure? Yeah. So the monetization, it works. They're making a lot of money. You can see this from their public companies. You can just look at their annual reports and it's gone from 100% box sales to at least half of it is digital sales via these products. And they're all copying the most successful aspects, of course. That's what the game companies do. So what questions counterbalance this money grab strategy?
Yeah. Yeah.
And then there's not a lot. No. So there are legal frameworks, but you have to enforce them. And it's an international situation.
And the legal frameworks in Europe are different from the US and China?
Well, and also sometimes the companies simply don't conform. They have to do something, but then they don't conform to the actual rules. And
like TikTok taking all the data.
Or it's a symbolic measure where 5 times a week I indicate that I'm 100 years old to get past an age check, and nobody's ever actually checked my age.
Yeah.
So then it's just a legal commitment that achieves absolutely nothing, because a 12-year-old can also do that.
Yeah.
And then there's really fairly limited counterbalancing forces. And massive gamer feedback can sometimes work. So gamers get angry.
Yeah, there was an example.
They get angry.
Yeah, but what was it? The example where you had to pay, you had to stay online the longest to win something? I think that was...
Well, in some games, they ask you to spend a lot of time, but with more financially extreme examples, people buy a game and then, for example, a Star Wars game, and then they figure out they cannot even play the character they wanted to play unless they pay extra money.
And then the protest is via social media.
The gamers
get
angry.
It's not like we have
angry.
A union for video gamers.
And then eventually the game gets adjusted. But what you see then is sometimes they just shift it to the next business model.
Okay.
So there's what Electronic Arts is doing is the loot boxes are obviously heavily debated. Some people think they're addictive. Some people think they're gambling. And they're just stepping away from a gambling type mechanism. And now they're experimenting with another mechanism that's basically...
What are they experimenting?
Well, what they did as an experiment is they removed the loot box with another loot box, but in this case, you can see what's in it. So then it's not gambling anymore. But the trick is you have to decide today, because tomorrow it's another loot box with the content. So now they moved away from gambling, but they create, you have to pay now or...
Yeah, so or lose it forever.
I log into FIFA and then I see I got Ronaldo. Then I have to buy him because Ronaldo is really good.
Yeah, and he only comes around every so many days.
He never comes around.
So all that money.
And you don't know when he comes around because the exact statistics are hidden. Yeah. Nobody knows.
Yeah. It's the unexpectedness and then you sort of time pressure instead of the lottery aspect.
So and then in the absence of control, it's up to the individual goodwill of the companies to actually make changes.
Yeah.
And what you see then is that some companies indeed do the right thing. And
sort of notorious do-gooders and do-betters? I mean, are there companies where you know, okay, it might not always work, but at least they're trying, they're transparent, they have ways to address these? Or is the game industry as such, where I'm sure a lot of people work who are not evil people, but who work with mechanics that might have these results, but can you reach them? I mean, is this a closed world, or can you actually have this conversation across academics, industry, specialists?
The question is, if there, I know that there's design people watching this lecture as well.
Absolutely.
So the question is, where is the code of ethics? Where is the things you will not do?
Yeah.
And obviously, we're not advocating, like China, banning entire games, but there should be limits at some point to what you can do. And either financial limits or certain mechanisms that you will not employ in the case of children. And this is what we're trying to at least to get the conversation started on.
Yeah. Yeah. And you would like to have those limits also at the beginning of the design. Eh? So when you were addressing the, you're mentioning the legal frameworks and enforcing them, it's always, you know, when things are happening and then there needs to be a supervisory authority who are going to look into games, which they do, by the way, but they can't look into all games, obviously, because it's a lot of work. So that's a capacity issue, or you need to go to court. Well, in the case of TikTok, we have this mass claim.
But it will take years. I
mean, yeah, but you will represent a lot of users because the damages are all very small. Eh? So you're not going, as a gamer, you're not going to court.
I want my 20 coins back.
You're not going to do that. So yeah, there is a limit in the extent to which that can actually work. But you would actually like to have something more at the beginning of the game design to have the conversation there. But yeah, I agree with Tony. There is a lot of money going on there and money talks. And you could even have designers in a company that actually want to do the good thing. But there's also the marketing department. There is the CEO that wants to, you know.
Targets.
There's also like the aspect of like actually understanding from a research perspective which patterns are negatively like affecting people, right? It's like we have a few very clear examples, but there's also like some that are more questionable and right, like they're driving potentially like enjoyment, but at what point do they tip over like it being problematic, right? So like,
but isn't that also something that unfortunately is also almost on an individual level, because the one person, you know, sure, I won't buy the box. I mean, another is very sensitive to those pressures. So
well, that's a open research question, right? It's like how many people are affected like off certain mechanics, right? So it's like when we come to gambling, right? It's like not every one of us is equally like susceptible like to being affected by those mechanics, but especially like I guess like when we come to children, like there's also a question of like how much are the parents like involved in those conversations and discussions, help them to understand, right? Like, and coming back to the language of you know, and the consumer themselves, of positioning themselves of what's happening like in around them, they need to be able to talk and speak about like those mechanics to kind of figure out what actually influences them negatively, right? So
but it's true. I mean, but so you have the law, you have the personal responsibility, the development of a language and a conversation of the people that use these games. But in the end, what you want is that the game developers themselves and the game companies themselves are more aware of the mechanics. Well, they're super aware of the mechanics. Let's put it that way. They know how they work. I mean, they are not there by accident. They're there on purpose. Mm-hmm. But that they are aware of their responsibility in the lives of so many people, and want that you have to make them want to change it, because if not, they will go from mechanic to mechanic to mechanic, right? I mean, their goal in life is to have your time and your money in a way, right?
But that's the definition of a
there's nothing wrong
a
with that, because
is
that's
a
why
vehicle to make money.
Yeah, for, that's for why we have these beautiful games, because they're I mean, if you look at the games and the times it takes to develop them, they're like cathedrals. There are hundreds of people working many, many years to establish a game that.
I think it is related to industry maturity as well. So if you have a product that's consumed on a global basis, there needs to be a certain maturity about who's using your product and how you deal with them. And it is a fact that there are vulnerable gamers present, and also children who don't oversee what you're doing to them.
Yeah.
And then on the other hand, you have a really strong power position as a gaming company dealing with all the data, because you have all the data.
Yeah.
You know exactly which small percentage of people are spending extreme amounts of money.
Yeah.
And why is there no check on the maxima for money spending?
Yeah.
The only country that's doing that globally is South Korea, who has legal agreements on the maximum amount that adults and children can spend in the games.
Uh-huh.
But why do people need to be able to spend 30,000 euros in a month on a game?
Yeah.
Is that really?
Nobody out
it's
there
not even
stop
in the
it.
Company's best interest, probably, because it's only a few people.
Yeah, yeah. And the story comes out, and everybody.
They probably can infer some aspects of the vulnerable consumers that are using the games.
Mm. Okay, you say they should and could use the data on us as individuals to find out who is extra vulnerable, and or just do a grand cap. You know, you can never spend more than an X amount of money.
Well, it's a bit like the gambling system, eh? So that where you need to register as a player, and
you have to show your passport before you can play the casinos.
And if you show problematic gambling behavior, they can step in and set limits on how long you can play or how much money you can spend. But
that's quite a proposal. I mean, that's really going into the heart of a game company and influence. Do you think that you could convince them of that? Or is that more something like there should be an EU directive saying we need to have an agreement that we protect vulnerable players and that could be how we protect them?
I think there's an opportunity now for the game industry, a temporary opportunity to get things sorted. And if they don't, people will catch up to this and they will get regulated. Yeah. Because doing real-time experiments on people to maximize only your monetary gain is, as soon as people figure it out, there's going to be some sort of backlash.
Putting it
harshly. And we're seeing it happen, right? I mean, increasingly big tech companies are under fire. There are proposals to establish new regulators in the UK, now also in the United States, because dedicated oversight is missing and understanding of what's going on.
Yeah. So there will be more oversight anyway. They might as well step up now. Warning to the game companies. In the research, you've made a beautiful visual of the landscape that you have researched. Maybe you can have the first slide up. It was already visible a little bit ago. Let's see the slide. Because it sort of, yes, it shows where the behavioral design takes place, who is involved, what is the world we're talking about. Because one of the points you make is a lot of people involved in this are not completely aware of it, not who is involved, where it happens, who is in the lead and who could do something. Now, if you look at this visual, how does this need to change? There should be some oversight authority somewhere maybe, and there should be every game company should have a responsible game department, or maybe I'm just trying to figure out, what do you guys think?
Well, maybe you want to do the gamer and I'll do the game companies or vice.
Yes, because you look at it from the game, the game company, or you start with the gamer. Yeah. From the point of view of the gamer, what needs to change?
I think from a point of a gamer, there's like one part is to actually be aware of what's happening like within the game, right? So having kind of like a clear understanding of what am I exposed to? What am I getting into here? I think that's one part. I think the other part is also like to learn about like how to self-regulate kind of in this context, right? So we think about the gamer as like, oh, they're fixed in understanding like these kind of products, right? So, but there's this aspect of like really learning how to engage and disengage like in gameplay as well, right? So I think that's something that's helpful to kind of like emphasize as well when like learning about when enough is kind of like enough, right?
Yeah.
So, and I think that's like important like from a public conversation side as well of like talking about how we learn and improve really our behavior in those environments, right?
Yeah.
So I think
that's because what we didn't discuss is also this idea of the game mechanics to use it to change people's behavior for
that's
good,
right.
You know, to make them more creative. Exactly.
But so coming to that part, like before that, I think there's like building friction like into games, for example, right? I talked about like the example of like going to dinner, right?
Yeah.
So like just recognizing the moment of where I keep on continuing, like having this 10 seconds of like being able to adjust maybe what I actually want to do and not falling in this loop of continuation, right? Is from a design perspective, something that's very easily achievable. It doesn't necessarily conflict with your business model. It just doesn't optimize behavior like to a point where I unconsciously make decisions that I don't at the end want to make, right? So that creates conflict like on other sides. So I think that's a good aspect. And then the other aspect, of course, it's like highlighting really like the happy parts of engagement, right? Like the parts where we really enjoy play and like leveraging creativity, leveraging social parts of it, right? Engaging into stories and narratives, learning about like moral decision making, like lots of interesting kind of things in there.
And also
right?
this, I mean, we've seen this the last year, of course, the sheer doing something together with people that are not in the same place. I mean, that's something that is so strong now.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Or just having some time, you know, like where you really can take your mind off of everything else, right? Like I think that's like something we also need as a space, you know, for some that might be a warm bath, for others that's like an hour of engaging in play because they're so occupied for a moment and they just enjoy that. And the game provides them every bit of information to really go down that road of fully immersing themselves like into a game environment, right?
Yeah.
You know, sometimes that's really restorative.
Yeah.
And they're willing to pay. Gamers are willing to pay to support a good company.
Yeah.
And that's a positive motivation. But what we're seeing is that the negative motivation is also being used.
Yeah.
Change the game so that it becomes so frustrating that you end up paying just to stop the endless pain of doing the same thing over and over and over again until you find it by mistake.
Yeah, yeah, that's one of the other things. That just endless repetition, you could also pay and then you move on.
If you pay, you're done with this. Yeah. Then it becomes a job and not a game.
So what other perspectives do you have from the gamer, from gaming itself?
The game industry is a big group of companies, and it's not just the designers, it's also game publishers and also game distribution platforms like Steam and game stores. Yeah. So it's a complicated
industry. And it's very much a global market as well. It's not a...
the game gets designed and decisions are made to implement the business model. And the question is, what is the translation of the business model to the consumer's behavior against their expectations when they're playing the game?
Yeah.
And I might expect what Max is coming from, to play the game and have fun and be treated fairly. But then they end up, from the business model side, they end up frustrating me and making me do the same thing 40 times in a row before I figure out they're just making me do the same thing 40 times in a row just to get my money, to intentionally frustrate me. And this is what's actually new.
Yeah.
So the business models are affecting the games. The games are being adjusted to make more money, to optimize for financial gain.
And right now there's not a code of conduct to not use those mechanics in those ways. I mean, there is no agreement in the industry even about what is very acceptable and what is on the edge and what is...
It's discussed within the industry as well, like how to shape like kind of their ethical and responsible behavior to the consumer, right? Like I think they're, especially the larger companies as well, like they want to build healthy relationships like with their, but from a marketing perspective alone, right? From a public view perspective, having large groups of people that enjoy how they're treated and respect that is, I think, quite important. And gamers are quite vocal about those parts as well, right? So I think building out that part is definitely discussed like within the game industry, and people are looking into how to develop codes of ethics.
Because
that's what
the report does as well. It, as the subtitle says, a roadmap for ethical and responsible games that contribute to long-term consumer health and well-being. This is what you want. What is the roadmap? How do we go from here to a world where that's the case? And there will still always be problems, but where that's the case, are there certain steps that the industry can take together based on this report, together with policymakers? Well, because policymakers here have a role as well, right? I mean, they have to alert the audience even.
It starts with being honest and open.
Yeah.
So right now, everything is closed. There's no access to data except for a few individual researchers. It's not clear to gamers what's going on. And that's becoming increasingly problematic with the algorithmic decision making and things you're not even aware of if you're well informed about games.
Yeah.
So a good step would be to create massive openness and access to what's going on. And that would really restore a lot of public trust, I think.
Yeah.
But if that's not magically going to happen, then we need, we need some efforts on the national governing bodies. So governments need to be aware of what's going on. There needs to be some sort of oversight on what's being done within those games.
Yeah, policy makers need to be aware, and there needs to be a way that they can interact with the industry as well.
And as we notice in this conversation, it's really hard to even discuss what's going on because we're missing half the information. We can just see the results.
Yeah. Well, the report is super in that. I mean, all those mechanics and all those dark patterns, and also with examples from Fortnite and all kinds of games, that is very insightful to just be aware. I mean, a lot of these tricks are also used in e-commerce and apps and other.
Yeah.
But to see it, okay, this is actually what's going on. You know, this is what is going on all the time. Is the route via the children's option maybe the easiest one? Because that's where... Nobody wants to be seen as predators of all the children of the world. So the things that could be done for children are maybe things that could be done for all famous, but we could start there, right? We could start.
Yeah, in an ideal world, that's also what I'm always saying. if they get it right for children, I would be happy as well, you know. Also
exactly,
on social media and everywhere. But obviously, that's a bit idealistic, maybe, or even naive. Well, I think part of the answer is in something that Tony said very quickly. A lot of these companies actually try to exclude children, or at least younger children, by having age verification. It's always being done in a way that they can still enter.
It's not adequate
age verification.
Yeah.
This goes to show that they actually do want those children there as well, because it's their interest. You know, they're good customers, and they're even more vulnerable. I don't know whether that is an explicit strategy, but children have more and more money to spend, so obviously they are they're interested in them as customers as well. Having said that, so that's a bit of the being a bit cynical. Having said that, I think the children's rights framework that we've also set out in the report does provide some pointers that we can use also to maybe convince the policymakers and governments that they do need to step in here. And one of the things I would like to see is that the children have a right to have their best interests taken into as a primary consideration when an activity is impacting them. Well, clearly this is an activity that is impacting them. And impacting them also in a way that is maybe not good. And one of the things to actually see how to implement that is to use a child impact assessment. So what you need to do is to have a look at, well, how is what I'm doing impacting children, both in positive ways and in negative ways, and how am I going to address the negative ways? How am I going to implement legal requirements that are out there? And I have, talked about that. We do have legal obligations there. How am I going to implement them in an age-appropriate way? Also make sure that you involve children and parents themselves, because they know what their experiences are, how they are impacted, what their wishes are, their needs are, in terms of... So that is a very nice framework to actually use in the design of your products when they're going to be used by children as well. And we always say, based on the UN Convention of the Rights of the Child from 1989, all governments all across the world have signed them except for the US. So we're all bound by that convention except the US. Also the Dutch government. So basically, it is a legal obligation for the government to make sure that this is observed. But I would like to see it as a legal obligation in the law, and as something that you need to do before you start, and you need to keep on doing, because
show that you're doing it.
You need to show. I would also like them to publish it, but you need to keep on doing it. But because by using the game, there's a lot we don't know yet. But by using games, you will see, you will get a lot more information on what the impact is. So it's also something that you need to keep on doing. Mm-hmm. And that is something very concrete that I would like to see policymakers do.
Okay, so this is both to policymakers, to game companies, and also actually to game players to be aware of it. And you know, we have one more slide showing some of the directions, because of course this is a roadmap. This is one first step, is getting the conversation going and identifying the mechanics that are in place. And I think this report will be read both by policymakers that think like, oh, is that how it works? As well as by game designers that think like, ah, that's how it works. Because it is a complete list of, a long list of all the mechanics and the patterns that are being used in game design. I think you are in this for the long run. This is not going to be solved overnight, but I think it's the right direction. So
we are aware, and to be the typical researcher, we also need more research.
Thank you.
Because we have absolutely half of the information, and for some things, we know enough to know that there's something serious going on.
Yeah.
But we really need more tangible grasp and data-driven methods that clearly show where the borders are in and manipulating people's behavior.
I would like to say, okay, you need the game companies involved, but it's also very good to do completely independent research of what the game mechanics are, because the game companies do have...
Which is quite tricky because of the scale of the data and like the scale also of the games, right? Yeah. So like building, for example, like from a research perspective, right? Building like an entire game that's commercially successful that has all those properties, right? Sure, that's feasible, and we might need like projects on that large scale, right? But that's quite an quite expensive endeavor and quite time consuming. But that kind of control over data and information from a research perspective, right, is like what we wish for. And I think the only way
we want to build a simulated game to find out what the mechanics really are, because that's the only way you can get the data.
That's one direction, right? Like the other one is like kind of to work like with game companies, establish like those relationships. In a way, and I think there's a little bit of past here, like between game companies and researchers as well, right? Like, because especially the violence debates, like in the beginning of 2000, quite harmed the relationship between game industry and researchers, right? So that's something
they're not that open.
I think there is trust to be rebuilt as well, right? Because I think there are companies that want to do really good in there, right? And leveraging those relationships to gain further like insights in there as well. Is a pathway that I can see in the short term also working.
Mm-hmm. I would love to take this Dutch-based report to be the start of that conversation with a lot of game companies
that'd
as well.
Lovely.
Yeah. We almost have to round up, but we do want to show for anybody that's watching right now where you can get the report. So maybe you can see the slide. Right now you can find a full PowerPoint slide outlining a lot of things. The final report's not on there yet, but will be very soon. And it's also the place to get in touch with the people involved here. I have a question here that we round up with. It's not just dark patterns. It's not just dark patterns. Also white patterns. There's patterns that games can really help us all to lead better lives, right? Thank you very much for this conversation.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.